He's a writer, he's a poet, he's a teacher, he's a spiritual, a religious science practitioner, and he is a minister of this teaching. May I ask that you put your hands together and welcome our wordsmith, Reverend Michael Record.
Thank you, dear heart. Good morning, friends. Before I speak, I have a little treat for you. Carol, Valerie.
Good morning.
Good morning, Carol.
Reverend Michael, always being the teacher, is giving you instructions this morning. So, you all know the song. It's called You Are the Face of God. Okay? You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart. You are the face of God. You are a part of me. You are the face of God. You got that? You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart. You are a part of me. You are the face of God. We're going to start it with you are the face of love. Then you are the face of God. Okay, for the second verse. Now, here are the instructions. You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart. You are a part of me. You are the face of God. Got that? Okay. Let's try. We're going to start with love first. Start over here. You are the face of God now. You start.
You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart. You are a part of me. You are the face of God.
Everybody.
You are the face of God. I hold you in my heart.
And so were you, Carol, and so were you, Valerie. Thank you so much. And Sandy, thank you so much for reading that initial poem about Abu Ben Adhem. It relates, of course, to my talk on loving your neighbor this morning, as long as his wife or husband doesn't find out. I salute those worshiping here in this church, as well as those hearing me via the internet. I asked for the song Face of God / Face of Love, partly because of Mother Teresa, who was, as most of you probably know, was recently made a saint by the Pope. She said that she was able to see the face of God in everyone she met. We all need to develop that ability. That development comes with practice. The same sort of diligent practice that youngster from Sherwood Content in Trelawney undertook in order to make himself the greatest indisputably of all time. I suspect his records will never, his achievement will never be even equaled, much less surpassed. If he can do it, with practice, so can you. I don't mean you can become a Usain Bolt. I mean you can become a Mother Teresa, seeing the face of God in everyone you meet. You have gotten the advice that you should have that ability from many important people over the years, I know. One of them is the prophet Isaiah, who thousands of years ago, we're going way back now, in this poetic passage from Isaiah chapter 58, reports on God chastising his people about their hypocrisy, inconsistency, and fundamental lack of love for their fellow men. This is what God says in poetry to Isaiah. Shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? Yet, on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife, and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed or lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourself in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. End of quote from Isaiah. The message there is that if you help the needy, as Mother Teresa did, God will reward you handsomely. My playwriting student at Edna Manley College also believe we should love one another. They arrived at that conclusion in the first class I had with them at the EMC a couple of weeks ago, via, I admit, a rather roundabout route. I would like to take you on that journey. You'll find it interesting. The journey began when I told them that earlier that morning, just as I started thinking about my sister Hillary, the phone rang. It was her. Most of the students said they had had somewhat similar experiences. And I extrapolated from that that everybody in the world had them. Logically, I argued, that meant that all humanity was connected. So what connects us? It had to be the type of energy that we call thought. And we all agreed there in the class that there was also thought connections between humans and animals, which meant, we're being very logical here, that all life forms were so connected. We agreed that that thought network, since it stretched around the world and encompassed all thinking creatures, must be very powerful. Now, if it is powerful, it must be creative. I said, you can't have power and not use it to do something. We agreed to that from thousands of years ago, people must have figured out that the existence of that thought network. I said those people must have given the network a name. We are naming creatures. So what name, I asked them, did they give to that thought network? Someone said, God. I said, I thought so too. So now you are aware a creative power connects you with everyone else, that you are all part of one mind, I asked my students. Logically, how should you treat your fellow man? Their answer, in essence, was, you should love your neighbor as yourself. See how they arrived at that? My brother-in-law, Richard Bernal, is also coming around to that conclusion, though I'm not sure that he realizes it yet. But I know, because a year ago, he walked up to me at a dinner party we were at, and just out of the blue, said, Michael, visualization works. It was bizarre. We hadn't seen each other in more than a year. You know, he was abroad at the time. And there was no preamble at the dinner party. And I didn't get a chance to ask him what the devil he was talking about. By the way, when bizarre things like this happen to me, I look on it as God working out things in his mysterious way. So early last week, I got a chance to talk to Richard further on this matter of visualization working. His wife, my other sister Margaret, phoned to invite me to dine out with them and other family members. I was happy to go, as Elaine, my wife, was in New York, still is, and I had to cook my own dinner, hint, hint. The entire meal of rice and vegetables was in the rice cooker at the time that Margaret phoned. That was my deal, put it in the rice cooker, that's it. Bachelor life. When I arrived at the venue, this is the new Sovereign Plaza on Barbican Road. I hadn't even been aware it existed. Just up from Sovereign Center. The parking lot was full. But we sense of mind practitioners are not fazed by full parking lots. We drive into them optimistically, which is what I did. As I had expected, a car started to back out as I approached, and I took the space. Then I went upstairs to the Chinese restaurant where the family was gathered. So there I asked Richard about the visualization works statement, and he explained to me that he had visualized that he was in a post at the UWI where he was responsible for globalization. And lo and behold, very soon after, the vice chancellor came up to Washington where he was and offered him the very post. So Richard is now pro-vice chancellor for global affairs. He took up the job 1st of July. Now, this is not a man who is terribly spiritual. Very bright, but not. He would say so himself, not telling tales out of school. But he says visualization works. So for me, he's on the journey. But what's the connection between visualization working and loving one's neighbor? I argue it like this. If visualization works, that means you're connected to others by thoughts, creative energy. So we go right back to the reasoning of my playwriting students. By the way, I'm talking about visualizing important things, things that really mean a lot to you. Things that the universe can respond to deep in your heart. I'm not talking about visualizing silly things like being invisible or walking through walls. Somebody who is not here now said, that's what he'd like to do, walk through walls. Richard also said he was disappointed that visualization had not made him as rich as he'd like to be. But immediately he went on to admit that wealth has never been his primary preoccupation. It's rather, he said, being useful. Of course, my response to that was, well, there's your explanation. That's why you're not as rich as you think you'd like to be. I could have gone on to quote Emmett Fox that, you know his famous phrase from his booklet, life is consciousness. But that would have taken up a whole sense of mind class. And the Chinese restaurant was not the appropriate venue. So I turned my attention to my meal. Interestingly, the same rice and vegetables I'd left at home, plus, however, a dish of large, juicy shrimps. No, I love seafood. Now, let us hear from the man who not only tells us we must love our neighbor, but tells us we should love our neighbor as ourselves. Very, very important phrase there, as ourselves. In Matthew 25, Jesus tells the parable of the sheep and the goats. I quote, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothed you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. Unquote. I find that last statement very significant. At the beginning of the parable, Jesus identifies himself with the phrase, the Son of Man, with the king. And at the end of the parable, he identifies himself with, quotes, the least of these brothers and sisters. Now, think back to your math class. If A equals B and B equals C, then C equals A. So Jesus is saying, we are all one. The Son of Man, the King, the least of these, we are all one. Now, since we know he was capable of distance healing, I think he must have believed that we are all in one mind, the mind of God, which is what religious science teaches. Here's another personal story about mind connection. Banshee is not a word you hear every day. Until recently, I hadn't heard it for years. Then while I was in New York last month, I used it while speaking to my son, saying that his little daughter, my granddaughter, who was in the next room, was wailing like a banshee. That's the usual phrase, wailing like a banshee. He didn't know what a banshee was, and I told him, mistakenly, that I thought it was a wild African savage. I was guessing, for I'd never looked it up. I'd heard it all my life, but I'd never looked it up. And I promised myself to look it up when I got a dictionary back home. But back home, I couldn't remember what word it was that I wanted to look up. I knew there was a word, but I couldn't remember what it was. So early last week, while I was at a lab, another child, just a little older than my granddaughter, started bawling his head off in an adjoining room. Out came a woman who said to the boy's grandmother, who was sitting beside me, so-and-so, the boy's name, is wailing like a banshee. Twice in about a week and a half or so, after not hearing it for years. So immediately I asked the woman, what is a banshee? She gets out her cell phone, taps it a few times, and reads, and this is where I learned what a banshee was. Maybe you two are now learning it. A banshee is a female spirit whose wailing predicts the death of someone in the house. First time I knew that, banshee. Thought it was a wild African. Was it a coincidence that that situation there in the lab was so similar to the one in my son's apartment in New York? Was it a coincidence? We in religious science don't believe in coincidences. We believe, as Thomas Troward states in his book, The Creative Process in the Individual, that, I quote, order is heaven's first law. I have no doubt that the universe, God, sent that woman to answer my question about what is a banshee. But why did God do that? Because I sent out the request to the universe by setting my intention to get the meaning of the word. But, you may ask, would God really concern himself with that tiny matter? I mean, he has planets to keep in order, and he has world wars to deal with it. Well, We hear no, because there are no visitors today. We hear no, that the universe does not differentiate between so-called big and so-called small. So you set your intention, and God answers it. That's what Science of Man teaches. Religious science minister Tina May Wilding of Calgary, Alberta, wrote a beautiful Science of Man treatment, or affirmative prayer, about oneness using this epigraph by Dan Millman. I quote, "We appear on earth as separate beings with diverse destinies, but as each separate raindrop is a part of the sea, so are we part of the ocean of awareness, the body of God," unquote. That's from his book, The Laws of Spirit. And Wilding's paragraph in her treatment, which sums up the essence of this talk, runs as follows, I quote, "As I go about my day, engaging in my own dreams and desires, I am aware that those around me are also experiencing their own personal encounters with life. Deep within my heart, I sense our oneness, and from this place, I easily align with the hearts of others. I see no separation between others and me. I open my heart to give love, and in doing so, I am bathed in blissful peace and a sense of absolute calm. As I pour out my compassion into the world, it transforms my life for good," unquote. As I draw to a close, I want to go back to Richard's not being richer. He admitted that he was not focused on wealth. That means he did not expect it. And you need to know, maybe just need the reminder, that a major reason why prayers are not answered the way we want is because we do not expect what we ask for. The universe responds to our deep consciousness, and it is what we truly expect that we get, not merely what we pray for or want. So if we have a consciousness of lack, for example, but ask for abundance, what will we get? Lack. The universe responds to our deep consciousness. As a man thinketh, where? In his heart, not up here. Now, Valerie, I'm calling on you again. Where are you? Valerie? She's there? Now, to close off, please turn to your neighbor and sing one more time with feeling, "You are the face of God." Valerie, music please. Thank you. Here endeth the lesson. Now begins the practice. Namaste.